Our next, so we really designed this to kind of talk about how fermentation works, obviously then focusing on putting up silage and safety. And now we want to shift gears and talk a little bit about how inoculation works and also how this plan is changing to optimize harvest. So that's really what's left before our panel discussion here yet this morning. So our next speaker is Dr. Renato Schmidt. Renato's from Brazil originally, São Paulo State, and got his bachelor's and master's degrees there and got his PhD here at the University of Delaware. Probably, I said Dr. Bolson is Dr. Silage. This other person would be, if not close, maybe even similar, would be Dr. Lyman Kung. And so he got his PhD with him and has been with Lalemann since then, is based out of Milwaukee and travels really the globe talking about their products. So Renato, appreciate your expertise here and look forward to your presentation.
Thank you, Galen. Good morning, everybody. Very pleased to be here in Mead, or near Mead, Nebraska. I actually tried to ask Siri for driving directions when I got to the airport yesterday, and I guess the answer was, good luck with that. So I could find a place, luckily. Yeah, I had to figure out like a joke after, you know, coming after Dr. Rob Charlie and Dr. Keith Bolson. They were at like working when I was a toddler, so. Very good. Well, I'm going to talk about the impact of silage inoculation. And there will be more like some basic concepts, a little on the management as well, but mainly on the inoculants effects, what are they, what they do. Some of these slides, I may overlap with Bob's. So I don't know how come my supervisor decided to steal my thunder with his own slides. But nevertheless, we can save a little time on that. So for sake of time, I'm just going to breeze in some of those the slides that Bob went through. So in silage, we can define it as anaerobic process preservation of the nutrients. So we see we want to preserve most of the nutrients original from the plant. This is a naturally occurring process. So if you go to the field, we chop the forage, we bring to the silo, we seal it. Some way, somehow, we're having silage. So it's a pretty uncontrolled process. A natural occurring, it will happen, but then we want to make sure that, as on the third point, we want to preserve most of the nutrients and dry matters, as well as create a stable product. And one important point is that the oxygen is the main enemy of silage making. During the initial fermentation, during feed out, the first point is try to keep that air out of the system. And when we talk about the siling process, it's a very simple process. This is like a simple scheme that Bob presented on the first talk. What you're looking for, it's first the population of lactic acid bacteria to convert sugars to organic acids, or specifically lactic acid, ideally lactic acid, that's a very strong acid, and subsequently we're going to see this sharp drop on the pH. So after this phase of active in silage fermentation, we're going to see like minimal microbe activity and maintain that stable product to feed out. So we want to make sure that this initial phase is as fast and as effective as possible. So we're going to save most of the nutrients in the dry matter. And as it was already discussed earlier this morning, the plant is colonized by a wide variety of microorganisms. Some of them are beneficial, others are detrimental for silage making, but they all have a particular role in this process. And we see that what we call the good bugs, we can list the propionic acid bacteria, lactic acid bacteria divided by hetero and homo fermentative. And the bad bugs, we can list initially the fungi, yeast and molds, enterobacteria, clostridia, and bacilli. So this is, it comes to the point that one first, you know, the initial reason we could use or should use inoculants is that we can just reinforce this army of good bugs. So they're gonna have that battle, as Bob mentioned, and we're gonna make sure that these guys will prevail. So what impact we have from these detrimental microorganisms? Well, first of all, they're gonna inhibit some of the good microbes and compete with substrate and space for colonization. Second, they degrade proteins, good fermentation products, residual sugars, organic acids, all the good, the juicy stuff. And they produce undesirable compounds and heating. So all that microbe activity, especially the aerobic bugs, they're gonna be producing heat, and they also produce compounds such as butyric acid, putrescine, cadaverine, and those, just by the name, you see that they're not good. Also, you have like a decrease in the recovery of the dry matter, energy, and nutrients. And finally, we also have a problem with, potential problem with health hazards to humans and animals. So this brings us to the two goals of good silage making, as Bob mentioned. On the front end, we want the rapid recovery of nutrients, dry matter, shut down the plant enzymes, and inhibit the aerobic microorganisms. And on the back end, you want to make sure that you're going to have good feed out and storage characteristics. So what does that mean? It's good aerobic stability, so no or minimal heating and spoilage. Now, how can we help these two goals, achieve these two goals with inoculation? So on the front end, we can help by improving the fermentation, making fermentation more efficient, saving more of the dry matter and nutrients. And on the back end, we need to prevent aerobic spoilage, particularly the metabolism of the spoilage yeast that will start all those heating events that we see in silage during feed out. So the microbial inoculants on this picture, you see this is just not the final commercial product, it's just the final bacteria from one of our production plants. It's still going to be mixed with dye and carrier. And according to Rich Muck, that did a lot of silage research in Madison at the University of Wisconsin, they are most used for to prevent Clostridial fermentation. In this case, we see more commonly on wet forage, wet haylage, such as alfalfa and grasses. So you're looking for that quick attainment of the low pH. Second goal, the different class of inoculants that I'll be discussing a little later, it's to improve aerobic stability. So here I have corn silage, high moisture corn. Those are, you know, more typical or more prone to aerobic spoilage. Also earlage, snappleage, they have more starch. But I've seen, you know, many haylage pits that they were heating in as high as 130 Fahrenheit. And in the end of the day, make a good fermentation better. You can always save more on the dry matter and nutrients. You can always make a good fermentation better. This is one question that I asked Dr. Bolson once, or I heard on the audience in a conference, and the question was, what should inoculate? And he answered, every single load. So you can always make a good fermentation better. And one important point is that inoculation is not a substitute of good management. You need to follow the good basic management rules. You have good level of management, then you get the most out of the inoculants. They are not a magical solution. So on some of the inoculants, first, the outcome of the silage fermentation will be determined by the dominant microbial species. So you get back to that microbial war. So the species that will be prevalent, that's the type of fermentation you're going to see. If you have more of a heterolytic bacterial population, you see some lactic acetic acid, a little of ethanol. It's mainly homolactic. It will be basically lactic acid as your final product. So among the beneficial bugs on the lactic acid bacteria, we can divide them on homofermentative and heterofermentative. Some of the really common species that are used In these products, Lactobacillus plantarum, Pediococcus pentosaceus, Pediococcus acidulatii, and we also have the heterofermentative, that's, for instance, there is Lactobacillus bruckneri and also Lactobacillus brevis. So this is a graph that was shown by Bob, and just to illustrate why we're looking for that homofermentative pattern of fermentation. You know, theoretically, we have 100% of recovery on the dry matter in this conversion. So we converge the sugars, the six carbon sugars, to two molecules of lactic acid. They are three carbon, so you don't lose any dry matter in the form of CO2. And this is, again, it's a very desirable compound because it's a very strong acid. It's about 10 times stronger than acetic acid or propionic acid. I mean, the heterolactic bugs, they are beneficial. They're just not as efficient as the homolactic, and they don't grow as fast as. And here in the bottom, we see the yeast and Clostridia. Those are the really bugs you want to shut down, you want to inhibit or kill. Just keep them quiet. Not only they're producing some nasty compounds like butyric acid, you're just going to lose a lot of material, and theoretic recovery is about half. What could it be? So using a homolactic inoculant, this is the classic type of fermentation profile or effect that you'd see. This was a study done in Delaware with my former advisor in alfalfa silage. You see on the first column the silage that was, the hillage was not treated, and the one that was inoculated with a homolactic inoculant, with a traditional inoculant. So you had like a lower terminal pH, higher amount of lactic acid, lower amount of acetic acid, so we shift that fermentation for a lactic acid at the main compound as a product. And we could shut down some of the plant enzymes, especially the plant proteases, some of the bugs that act on the protein degradation. So we had like a lower amount of ammonia nitrogen. So this is the typical fermentation profile that we see when you use homolactic inoculant. So how does that mean in terms of dry matter savings? This is a little more complete slide from Bob's presentation, since he was talking about the corn silage particularly. This includes some haylage. And you see that means you can always make a good fermentation better. You can always improve the fermentation. The magnitude of response, that will vary. So you might have a small response, a pretty good size, almost like a two-digit response on the dry matter savings. But then at the end of the day, on these studies that were done with our bugs in independent research institutions, it went basically almost like 5% on savings. And when I get the question, okay, how much should I expect dry matter saves when I use a homolactic inoculant? I like to go a little more conservative and go stay around 4%. So just to play a little with numbers, what those 4% reduction dry matter loss are worth. So I think we're good. Where's Keith? Somewhere, bathroom break. So I think we hit like the same value on the price of the corn silage fresh weight. But then just to be a little on the conservative side, I considered $40 a ton. So at 35%, this would mean about $129 on a dry matter basis for the ton of corn silage. Therefore, each 1 percentile improvement dry matter recovery would be worth about $1.29. Considering this 4% improvement dry matter recovery, we would end up with $5.14. And this we're just thinking about the dry matter recovery, just quantitatively. We're not thinking about how much energy I'm losing, my true protein, if there are some nasty compounds being produced, something that will affect animal production, fertility, health. So this is, just as Bob said, just on this calculation, you get the investment paid. So I've been talking about the traditional homolactic inoculants, characterized by deficient production of lactic acid. We get greater dry matter energy recoveries. Now there is one, let's say, a potential setback with the traditional inoculants, is that there is an insufficient production of antifungal compounds. Oh, we got a lot of lactic acid there. Yes, but lactic acid does not have good antifungal properties. So in fact, as it was shown earlier, the spoilage yeast, they can start the deterioration process using lactic acid that we want at the beginning. So it's kind of catch-22. So now we're switching to the back end. How can we help that? Well, one first alternative is to use propionic bacteria. So this bacterium produces propionic acid and acetic acid. They both have good antifungal properties. Propionic acid, it's, you know, it's really commonly used as a chemical. Everybody knows, but acetic acid has the same mode of action, the same properties. Now, the only problem with propionic bacteria is that it's not very tolerant to a really low pH. So it might not be the best option, for instance, in corn silage, that we have a faster rate of fermentation and a low terminal pH. So this is just like a simple schematic of how the fermentation goes, that the propionic bacteria use residual sugars, glucose, some lactic acid, and convert to acetic and propionic acids. And those will inhibit the yeast, and you end up with a higher aerobic stability. So aerobic stability, just to define, it's the period of time or amount of hours the forage, it's still fresh, it's still cool, compared to the ambient temperature. That's how we measured. Once it's about 3 Fahrenheit higher than the ambient, it just start heating and becoming spoiled. So this is one piece of research that showed the profile that we should expect when you use a propionic bacterium. You see that that was used in high moisture corn, so it's a slower rate of fermentation, also a little higher terminal pH compared to corn silage. We see the amount of lactic acid was basically the same, but then when you look at the amounts of acetic and propionic acids, we see the effect of using the propionic bacterium. And on the population of yeast, there's still 4.941, but this is on the log scale, so it's almost 10 times lower the population of yeast on the treated high moisture corn compared to untreated. So we have some limitation with the propionic bacteria, and if there is some history with the heating or some really challenging conditions, such as removing silage or the pit is really far away from the feeding center, or we had some drought stress corn or some hail damage someplace, some situation that we have this real strong challenge on the feeding out, then the alternative is the Lactobacillus buchneri 4788. So Lactobacillus buchneri is a very unique lactic acid bacteria because during the period of storage, it will convert moderate amounts of lactic acid to acetic acid. So during the initial phase, it's a lactic acid bacteria produces lactic acid, some other compounds, but then after that, it still kind of hangs on there and it's starting just, I think it's basically a survival strategy. It converts some of the lactic to acetic. And the acetic will work pretty much as the propeth, as I mentioned. We will inhibit the spoilage yeast molds, improve the shelf life of the silage. You have less losses during the storage feed out and maintenance of animal performance. So this is the unique pathway of L. buchneri. So it's stimulated by the low pH and the high amount of lactic acid, so it starts converting it to equal amounts of acetic acid and 1,2-propendiol. So 1,2-propendiol, it's propylene glycol, so it'll be a precursor for the energy metabolism of the animal, so it's a good compound. And there's like some trace amounts of ethanol that are produced, about 1 or 2%, so it's negligible. And also this 1,2-propendiol, sometimes it's converted to propionic acid. We don't see really often, you know, the acetic acid hangs there. We can really see in the fermentation analysis. But once you probe, it's converted to something else. And if you have that particular bug that's called Lactobacillus dialovorans, it converts to propionic acid, which is another good preservative. So since this bacterium, it's really particular, when we start doing some research about the effectiveness, we saw that at the traditional application rate, that's 100,000 CFU per gram, the results were not really consistent. So then, this was before my time in Delaware with Liminkang, they decided to do a dose level study to see, okay, how much more we need to apply in order to get a result. And they saw that around 500,000 CFUs, you plateau, and it wouldn't matter if you double that dose to 1 million CFUs. So if you think it's a lot more cells, a lot more bacteria that you have in the product compared to the traditional inoculants. And in fact, this is the only one that has the FDA approval with a claim on improvement in aerobic stability. It's the high dose of Lactobacillus buchneri. So we see that we reach a plateau on the acetic acid. What happens to the population of yeast? It's just suddenly, it's just boom. They're wiped out. They're all inhibited. And consequently, you see also this huge improvement in aerobic stability. So I think it brings back some of the practical class of analytical chemistry, that you're dropping a little reagent on a beaker with some other compound, and suddenly, poof, one drop, and the color all changed. So it's kind of like a similar concept, just an analogy with this dose level. So you need to reach a certain population of buchneri in order to get the result. So this was a study that Bob presented at the end of his presentation. That was a farm scale study done in Florida. And those were just the feed out losses. So there is a difference of 4.4 percentiles on the lower losses on dry matter. And then you think, okay, if I have 1,000 tons of corn silage, that would be 44 tons of corn silage that disappeared. So if you just consider, you know, how I'm going to replace this based on the TDN, this will be about 40 tons of ground corn. But then this is just the amount that's lost. We have to think of the material that was left. So you see on the protein loss and the loss of energy, this is a much lower quality compared to the material that was treated. So the material left still had most of the nutrients. And here on the bottom, you see, you know, the bad guys, the spoilage yeast. So where it wasn't treated, it went as much as, on absolute numbers, about, what, 6 million colonies per gram. And here on the was treated, log 4 is about 10,000. So it's a pretty dramatic difference. And this was another study. This was during my time at the lab in Delaware. And we did a study with L. buchneri, corn silage. We saw this, you know, the big improvement in aerobic stability was not news to us at that time. And we started scratching our heads like, okay, what else can we do? You know, we like to show the successes for stories, not when we almost blew up the lab. So we decided, okay, let's make a TMR with those two silages. So we made a TMR with untreated corn silage and a TMR with corn silage treated buchneri. And we see that this effect on shelf life or bunk life, if you will, carried to the TMR mix, you know, in a little lower magnitude, but you got the effect. And then we thought, okay, let's see, we are in this situation right here. We made a TMR, our corn silage was not treated, but it's hitting the bunk. So let's use some chemical, some TMR saver. So we already apply at 5 pounds per ton and 10 pounds per ton. And you can see that, okay, we got some effect, but it was not even close than using the silage that was inoculated. So this was much easier and more cost effective. And I like to, you know, to call this situation like, you know, you got like a bonus. This is another one of the bonus. It's you keep that silage stable so it has better hygienic qualities. This was some study done with corn silage, and the researcher decided to simulate contamination with E. coli. So he contaminate the silage during feed out, and after 6 days, they grab the samples, cultivate, and try to see how much E. coli was left. So you see in this first set of bars, that's the control treatment. So it wasn't contaminated with E. coli, so we didn't see any E. coli. The one here is the positive control. So he contaminated with E. coli, pretty high numbers, about 5 million colonies. This was another treatment with a homolytic product. And these two treatments worked with Lactobacillus buchneri. This is just the pure buchneri. This is a combination product. So there are, of course, there are combination products with a homolytic bacterium. So you target both ends. So you see that the pH was still low. So everything is nice, preserved, pickled. And on this treatment here on the far right, there was like no colonies at all of E. coli, and a much lower number on this treatment with the pure buchneri compared to these two treatments that peaked really high. Now, just I'm going to give some guidelines on the inoculant use. So have to make sure that you apply uniformly because the bugs are not going to be like swimming or going through the silage mass. If you're just having a bucket with the solution and throwing that stuff, you'll be just concentrating in a little pocket. Even the shower method, there is a research that showed that even though you dump the load and you use the blade and try to spread, it's not really uniform. So should use the applicators and make sure they're clean and calibrated. And remember this microbial inoculants, these products, they're living organisms. So we need to treat them properly. You know, they need to stay cool. Their worst enemies are the moisture, sunlight, and heat. So this was a field study that was from Dr. Kang's shop as well. This gal, she went to just to different parts in the country in the field. I think it was California, in the Midwest, and PA, New York. And she was just like stopping the harvesting, grabbing a sample, and analyzing for a whole bunch of parameters. Here is just, in my view, the most interesting. That's the expected count that you should see in the tank, and this is the temperature in Fahrenheit. So these are all the different tanks that she sampled. And the first thing that's what you would expect, it's okay, you're going hotter on the water inoculant mix, the viability of the bugs go down. So that was expected. But then you have all these different type of tanks, and those here with the open symbols, those are the dormant tanks. They are the insulated igloo type of tanks. So it's much easier to keep the bugs cool and happy so they had a better viability, especially compared to like black tanks or tanks that were near engine or not in a proper place on the harvester. And another two important points was like at 95 degrees Fahrenheit, half of the bugs were not viable. And when the temperature was 110, 90% were not viable. So you're just using 10% of what you should be applying. So these are just some guidelines how to choose an effective inoculant. You know, ask for data, independent research, reputation of the manufacturer. Try to, you know, you get your education on what they do and what's the best for your particular situation. Sometimes you have corn silage, but doesn't heat. You want to just save on the dry matter. Also, you know, think about custom service, tech support, quality control. And the cost should not be the primary factor. You know, I try not to confuse, you know, value and price. So in summary, the silage fermentation can be a very uncontrolled process, but using a proven silage inoculant to improve fermentation and or aerobic stability will help maintaining the forage quality in the silo. And remember, the basic management recommendations should still be followed when using microbial inoculants. They are not a magical solution. And finally, make sure that the inoculants, you know, they are alive, properly handled and applied on a calibrated applicator for optimal effects. And I think this is all I had. Thank you. I'll be happy. Happy to entertain any questions, comments.
How many questions, Dick?
You wish, hi. Yeah.
All right, let's thank Renato.
Thank you.